September 14, 2020 is the slated delegates conference for the Forum for Democratic Change. However, all seems not to be well in the largest opposition party in Uganda. To discuss whether the center can no longer hold on the checkpoint tonight is the party president of the Forum for Democratic Change, Honorable Engineer Patrick Amuriat Oboy. My name is Nicholas Wasaja, and thank you for keeping it up. Honorable, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Nicholas, and thank you very much for bringing me to the show. I greet you all viewers of Urban Television. What an introduction. All is not well, and it reminds me of what has been trending on social media and mainstream media, where the speculation about the collapse of the FDC, you know, shouting headlines, trying to point at you know, so many bad things happening in the FDC. And I think it's a representation by the media. And
Honorable, is it a misrepresentation? You have a number of people who are in parliament and they are saying they are not going to stand on the FDC ticket. You have others that are quitting, for example, founding members like Honorable Abdu Katuntu. They are saying, me and FDC, we are done. It seems there is a fire burning. What could be the cause of this?
That is not synonymous with collapse. It isn't. In this country, we have about 45 million people, of which probably, you know, 12 to 15 million are registered voters. Leaders are a creation of the people. And really, for you to describe our situation as dire, you know, a party on drip, because members of parliament who represent people have left the party, is really not an accurate statement. And I think that what is important at this point in time is not the actions of leaders, but what is happening in the population. Not that the leaders are not important. For me, in my leadership, since I took over 2.5 years ago, I've always looked for this one sheep that is lost, left the 99 that we have secured, and gone to look for or to seek the 100th sheep that is not in my flock. But one needs to understand why these leaders are leaving.
Exactly. Probably what we are saying is not that it's a collapse, but there is a problem, and that is why we are talking to you. Where is the problem coming from?
I think you are right about a problem, which in my description is a minor problem. But the question where the problem is coming from, I think it's historical. Of course, the formation of the FDC was as a result of different entities coming together. The leaders of these entities, the Honorable Chapa Karuhanga, who came with his group, Dr. Kizza Besigye, who came with Reform Agenda, and Honorable Augustine Ruzindana, who came with PAFO. Many of us belong to both PAFO and Reform Agenda, because I was a member of parliament then when the FDC was founded. And so within the FDC, I began to notice that our approaches to politics differed, maybe informed by the fact that we came from different backgrounds. And so that laid the foundation of what was supposed to, well, that would be play out in the future years. But I don't want to delve in the past so much, the distant past. And when I talk about the distant past, I'm talking about 15 years ago. I would like to bring viewers to the very near past. And this is to do with the very time when I got into the position of leadership as the FDC president. I had always been a backbencher, somebody who could go unnoticed, although I was a member of parliament, you know, for 15 years. I had never been that ambitious, you know, looking for positions, because I thought I already had a position in which I would be able to propagate the ideals and values of the FDC and also represent people and speak for them. I had a platform. But once that platform was removed, again forcefully, by the junta, who harassed my people in the constituency and, you know, took over the will of the people, they overthrew the will of the people, I found myself having a little bit of time to practice politics outside representative politics. And so then this opportunity came, and I said, why don't I give it a shot? It initially took a lot of convincing and confidence building in me for me to accept to run against General Muntu. Now, as it turned out, the heavyweights of the party had been influenced by General Muntu, probably because of his style of leadership, maybe his association with them. I can never tell what informed. They are going there. And just narrowing this argument to parliament alone, out of the nearly 36 members of parliament then, I had only 8 on my side.
Yes, well, the other 26 supported.
The other ones were on the other side. And I came in this race as an underdog, despised.
Why you are an underdog?
I don't know. That question should go to people.
If you are able to defeat an incumbent and with the backing of the founding president.
Before even that, that is how my candidature was seen. It was viewed that way.
Who could view and, a candidate and, of someone?
Just listen, you go into a race and they say, nobody cannot manage. It was said, Nicholas, this was mentioned. They said, he can't make it. So the belief by especially the heavyweights of the party, notably the members of parliament, was that, you know, I had no chance in this race. And so they put their everything. And sometimes, again, there were insults also thrown at me. So what is he trying? Does he have the financial resource? He can't make it. You know, he will not even manage the party for a day. So that mindset really caught the imagination of the people who thought I was there for introductory purposes and maybe for future purposes in terms of leadership. Now, when the result came out, my friends did not accept the result. At first they thought it was a rigged election. The election was carried out transparently. So even the voices that initially said, no, but they have cheated, the election said, no, we have been defeated.
And your opponent accepted that he had been defeated?
Yes, that is not the issue. The issue is how did they conduct themselves when I took office. Immediately they began to fight a war that was unnecessary. And that is when, in December, despite insistent, you know, persuasion, you know, attempts to persuade General Muntu. Actually, after my own election and swearing, I went on to extend an olive branch to everybody who was on the other side. And I had meetings upon meetings with General Muntu. And he said, you know, for you, you do not understand what has happened in that party. You will get to know. That is in his own words. And he did then go ahead to carry out consultations under the auspices of a group, the new formation, as it was then called. And he said, I am going, whether you like it or not. And so for us, we exercise freedom. I couldn't stop General Muntu going out to the countryside.
But you see, Honorable, I'll put it to you that you probably have failed to bring cohesion in the party, which you promised in the delegates conference as part of your manifesto, because these are the same challenges that General Muntu faced when he defeated Nandala Mafabi, and there was a lot of bickering, but he was able to steer the boat.
Listen,
when you
listen
came,
to
you
my complete story.
Wrecked it.
Nicholas, be patient, hold your fire. So when he went out, he consulted with our own members. Some of them told him, please get back to the party. But they remained defiant. And that defiance culminated into the formation of the Alliance for National Transformation. And, you know, all sorts of declarations, especially by our members of parliament, who were, I think, carried away by anger over the loss. And, you know, that was really the turning point. Now, to answer your question directly, there is this breakaway coming, you know, being thrown on my face. No other leader of the FDC had ever experienced a former party president exiting and supported by a number of members of parliament. It's Poa, only Poa, who has experienced that. Does it say anything in your mind, to your mind, that despite all that level of turbulence, and General Monti is not a small name in the politics of the country, he lives with a number of angered members of parliament, and yet the party still remains, that the party has not collapsed up to today, that the party is able to form grassroots structures, that the party is able to win over support even in areas that we had difficulties before, that we are now in the process of registering voters, and people are coming in, candidates, and people are coming in droves to take our flag. Is that the description of a collapsed party under the leadership of a weak leader? No, it isn't. So, from that background, and again, part of my successes is to tone down, and that is my approach. I am not going to take a tough stance of saying, you know, you have offended the party, we're going to bring you to the disciplinary committee. No.
But why are some members being locked out?
Just wait, let me explain this. I think that, again, you, the media, as I have always said, somehow you have chosen to misrepresent the FDC.
Oh, is it a misrepresentation?
We are face to face with Mr. Museveni. You are poking us everywhere. I describe this as a, you know, an attempt to gang rape the FDC.
If you're the alternative,
no, what kind of, you know, and again, we take offense about the kind of journalism that you people practice these days. You have failed this country. I think during the times of Wafula Ogutu, probably we had really balanced and level-headed journalists who did work, because they went to the root cause of this.
And that is where
you should not be asking those questions. You have already reported. The questions should have been answered already.
That is where we started, and you decided to put it aside. You said there was a challenge at the formation of FDC between the two tendencies that came from PAFO and then reform agenda.
And the other one.
You get it. And then the
National Democratic Party.
Yes. And at that point, there are people that exited the FDC. You get it, at formation, like David Pulkol, because they were feeling that probably what you had set out to do as a group had not been achieved in the formation. There are allegations that you people that came from Reform Agenda were more favored in the FDC. Do you agree to that? And they were given, FDC was positioned in a way that gives them more chance to practice leadership as opposed to people that came from PAFO.
I can only speak for the time I have been the president of the FDC, and accurately, that is for 2.5 years only. I don't take responsibility of what I inherited, because that is in the past. I cannot correct anything in the past. All I can do is to pick up the pieces from the past to inform decisions that will be taken in the party. But really, what I am demonstrating to you, is what happened in 2017, November 24th. And that is the point at which MPs took a decision, some of them, that they would leave the party. Now, bit by bit, we began to engage them. And the first person that I engaged among the MPs who had sort of dissented was the Honorable Ibrahim Ssemujju Nganda, the MP for Kira, whom I have a lot of respect for. We met in January, early January, and for me it was trying to understand what has caused the MPs, first of all, to get angry with an innocent person like me, and then also to withdraw their support to the party, because immediately I won, some MPs decided to withdraw their financial support. They stopped talking about the party and promoting it. They stopped attending crucial meetings of the party. And so as the whip, you know, I asked him, and by the way, for listeners, the Honorable Ibrahim Ssemujju Nganda was the campaign director, the chief campaign director of General Muttu. And he said to me, we are in pain. We feel pain. We are failing to absorb these laws, and we will do it at different times and at different rates. Give us time. That was his wise counsel, and I think it was wise. So I took a decision at the time to move on the members of parliament slowly. I engaged.
Were you able to reach out to all of them?
Yes, I even, you know, went to a number of times, went to parliament, sat in an empty room, you know, when I was promised that the members of parliament would come, I would walk away without seeing them. I exercised a lot of patience to try to get back our leaders, because we respect them. We think that, you know, they are the torch bearers of our party. Now, you should be curious to ask how many members of parliament, sitting members of parliament, would like to vie for their positions again, or other positions, to go to parliament. Yes, on the FDC ticket. And this has been revealed by the exercise that we are undertaking now. And I will say 25 have returned their forms. We are waiting for returns coming from our upcountry branches to confirm the number. And, you know, coming from 8 loyal leaders to 25 and still going and still counting is certainly not a mean achievement.
Right.
And we attribute this to our patience, sometimes painstaking patience.
Honorable, it's not that it's not a mean achievement, but you've talking to me on phone, you've told me that you do not expect regime change in 2021. So do you think these 25 picking nominations without necessarily going to a direct election would be able to deliver the desired change that you've been talking about?
We are going to that election with not only 25 candidates. Indeed, for every member of parliament who has declared their departure, parting ways with us, we already have candidates that have been proposed by our low-level structures. Remember that we began to see uneasiness within our members of parliament and some representatives in the council. In fact, there is a time we got intelligence of what was supposed to be a mass exodus of our leaders. And so we fought hard to reverse this. So our target is to field candidates in all elective positions for member of parliament and other positions. Whether we can achieve this is another question.
Honorable,
the exercise that we're undertaking now will reveal exactly what level of achievement we would have attained.
Honorable, you're going to field candidates, but you're also not sure whether you're going to win the 2021 general elections. You told me yourself that you're very pessimistic. You're not sure there is not going to be regime change in 2021.
Winning an election is different from regime change. And I just want to take you back to the election
of
2016. Let me just explain this. Take you back to the election of 2016. We won squarely, with evidence, 52.8% of votes cast were in our favor. But did Dr. Kizza Besigye become president of this country?
Horrible.
He didn't. So there is a marked difference between winning an election and taking over power.
Horrible.
So you could win an election by 80%, but so long as the dictatorship in Kampala says we are not going to have you in that seat, they will use all means to frustrate you, as they have frustrated Dr. Kizza Besigye, and you will not take over leadership of the country. Now, all we are saying to those who seem to have confidence in the exercise we are undertaking is that don't put all your eggs in an election. Because under the current situation, it's not going to bear results. And it's even worsened this time, because there is going to be a marked difference between the way we are going to conduct the election this time and the way elections have been conducted previously.
You know, that is pragmatic for a leader to send mixed signals, because this is not the first time. Ahead of 2016, you said we are going to boycott this election because there have not been electoral reforms, and you went ahead and participated in the election. You're now saying we do not expect regime change, we do not expect to win the election, but you're participating in the election.
Again, you make a mistake. We do not say we are not expecting to win the election. We go into an election to win. We do. But what is that win going to manifest itself as? It's the big question. You have won election. The purpose of going into a contest is winning an election. Or if whatever it was, if you went through a fight, if I engaged you and in a competitive fight, I want to knock you down, you know, and flatten you and be declared the winner. Now, I may knock you down, but if the referee says no, it is Nicholas who is the winner, and yet is the arbiter, what are you going to say?
Honorable, I would the say
bet will be given
very
to you and not to me.
To change the rules and the arbiter of the game.
Eh?
I would say you've done very little to change the rules and the arbiter
what
of the game.
What would we have done? The Electoral Commission was appointed by Museveni even after all our complaints. Today we have been singing for reforms ever since our inception as a political party 15 years ago, now coming to 16. We have seen gerrymandering, you know, in the creation of constituencies to favor fanatical supporters of the NRM, a generally uneven playing field is what we're experiencing today. All this we have talked about, but nobody is listening to us. The person holding power in Uganda today is not about to listen to us. And that is why we are going into this election on two fronts: the struggle front and the electoral front. It may have one leader for both fronts, or it may have separate leaders, depending on what the process that we are undertaking now of selection of presidential flag bearer will yield.
Honorable, on the electoral front, it seems like everyone is now poaching from the FDC. On the other hand, the opponent that you, the person you're opposing, the NRM, is either gaining from the FDC, or even his very same people are returning on bended knees. In Kamocha, the people that you hope not be in the opposition, the trove are that is in Kamwocha for people picking nomination forms is unprecedented. In Najjanankumbi, I would say people are actually running away from picking nomination forms from you. Why is this?
I invite you to go to Najjanankumbi. Just look at what is happening on social media. We are posting new posters every minute of people standing from across the country. And you know, ours, I do not intend to demean any political party. We have a countrywide network, and we have capacity to get candidates even from the most remote part of the country. I don't know who is running to Kamwocha or who is running to Chadondo. That is not my business. My business is who is coming to me, who is coming to Najjanankumbi. And I think really what you people are representing is an over exaggeration of the situation. And I will tell you this, by the time the country wakes up, the FDC would have progressed in the positive direction. And this is what we work to do every day of our lives as leaders within the FDC 24/7. We're actually working on this.
So is it going to be mere progress in the positive direction, or is it going to be winning this time round? Because, I mean, for those that agitate for change, it has been a long wait, 20 years plus.
Winning
promise after promise.
Winning, as I have told you, has not been alien to the FDC. We won in 2006. I can tell you this confidently, with a good mark. We won in 2011 with a relatively lower score. And this was as a result of the confusion over the IPC and branding. We won emphatically in 2016. So what other win are Ugandans waiting for?
Honorable, we are going to go for a
the Ugandans short. Have failed, and you have promoted the failure of people distinguished between a win and taking over power.
Honorable, we are going to go for a very short break. But when we return, I want you to tell me how, if, for example, your presidential flag bearer won an election with, for example, you say 52.8% votes in 2016, but with less than about 20 MPs in parliament, whether that presidential flag bearer will be able to maintain power for even 2 days, or whether they will be able to form government for that case. Let's break. Welcome back from that short break, and you're still watching The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasaja. Today we are hosting the Honorable Engineer Patrick Amuriat Oboy, Party President of the Forum for Democratic Change. Honorable, when we went to for the break, you had said winning has never been a problem for the FDC. But I was wondering if you've been able to say win the presidential elections, but with a very insignificant number of MPs in parliament, how would you be able to form government?
These are not comparable. Have you asked yourself the question why in parliament today we registered about 8% of the total number of members of parliament? And yet, in the presidential election, what was awarded to us, what we know is 52.8%. But even if we just considered what was given to us, it is about 32.8%.
32.8%.
Why the difference? We in this country do not run a system of proportional representation. And so you can have a strong candidate who captures the imagination of the population, presidential candidate that is, and wins. But then he can have fewer members of parliament, because the dynamics are different. those of us who have been practitioners in elective politics in this country for a long time know this very well. You might have a weak candidate at the level of LC5 or the level of Member of Parliament, whom people will not vote because there's something that is personal, you know, a personal weakness. You may even have more candidates for the position of MP. For example, DP may put a candidate, FDC, you know, JEMA, in one constituency. And then the dynamics change, and yet the presidential candidates may just be two. So the two are not comparable unless you are running a system of proportional representation, where the candidate goes and the percentage that the candidate wins, the presidential candidate, that is reflected in parliament. That is the only time when you can see the strength of a political party or of a candidate who bears the flag or carries the flag of that political party. But I think you bring a very fundamental question, Nicholas, and that is how you would run government yet you are in the minority in the House. I think that is a very important question for our viewers, and I would like to address it this way. Do you think that all these people who are NRM are actually committed to NRM, the MPs? I want to say no. Some of them actually have got their roots in the opposition. But they have gone to constituencies where the NRM is favored. Their desire is to represent their people. They want to go to parliament. They want to go to the local councils. To be fair to them, the only way they would get there is by posturing as an NRM supporter. I am sure that many of these NRM MPs are just hostage in the NRM. And I am again saying this from my experience interacting with MPs in the 15 years that I was in the House, talking to them in private. Some of them are living a terrified life within the NRM where there is no freedom. So the natural tendency, in case another person was declared and took over office, is for those NRM to close the floor. Many would do it. Many. And suddenly you would see that the majority would be members from the party that has won the presidential contest.
But would you also consider the fact that the very same MPs that you think would cross the floor would instead have take a vote of no confidence in the president, that you would, a minority president for that case? Why would they subject themselves to a person that they did not want to take the presidency, they did not support in an election, yet they have an option of,
you see, the MPs voting would begin breathing fresh air. They would run to the ruling party. A vote of confidence would never happen, or an impeachment of the president wouldn't. A reorganization of the politics would be done. And by the way, for us, we don't believe in winner take it all. If we declare the leaders of this, of government, we would open up to a transitional arrangement. We are actually advancing this, where we would want to include everybody, because of the political distortions that we have suffered as a country in these many years of the NRM monopoly. There would need to be something done so that we have a new beginning. For example, we don't have institutions in this country today that we can be proud about. All of them have been corrupted and taken over. Do we have a parliament that is not under the control of Mr. Museveni? Do we have a judiciary that is not in control of Mr. Museveni is, after all, the one who appoints all the judges, beginning from the judges of the High Court, all the way to the Supreme Court. Do we have financial institutions that are independent? No. They are all under the control of one man. Even the investigatory arms that investigate corruption, the army, the police, the security agencies, all those would need to be reorganized during the transition period. The second thing that would need to do within that transitional period is to unite this country. The country is being weighed down by tribal sentiments. These different ethnicities speak bad things against each other. Some of them think the others are responsible for the turmoil that is going on within their regions. You will hear, for example, that the northerners are the ones who killed people in Luweru. And the northerners will tell you that the southerners killed their people during the insurgency in the north. How can you pretend to be presiding over a normal country when there are such contradictions? And so we would want truth-telling, justice, and reconciliation to take place. The third thing is for us to re-examine our constitution during that transition period. The constitution was totally adulterated, reduced to a mere piece of paper. Every safeguards that would protect the people of Uganda from excessive use of power or domination of the nation have been removed, and removed forcefully, or using corrupt tendencies, using money. And so what is left of the constitution is something that cannot be recognized as the 1995 constitution. And so that is one thing that the transitional government should do. The last is to organize political parties so that we may have a free and fair election. That is what FDC wants to do. So the moment our presidential candidate is declared and sworn in, we are going to say, wait a minute, before we get into parliamentary business, let us see how we transit. And, you know, all political forces in the political spectrum will be invited for us to discuss the destiny of our country.
Honorable, you highlight the issue of corruption as one of the major challenges in this country. But observers say, besides intrigue and infighting within the opposition, it is equally bogged down by corruption. You remember there are stories against the FDC itself of failing to account to its donors, I think about 2 years ago. What would you say to this? How would you promise Ugandans that you will be able to stem corruption, which is the root cause of all these problems, yet even in the opposition, or furthermore, in the backyard of the FDC, there is corruption as well? We've had MPs of the FDC that have sided with the government on issues, accountability, that are pertinent to Ugandans.
Well, talking about maybe the MPs, we don't want to name names here. What I want to say is that if an MP is found carrying out an act of corruption, and we find that out, then they will face the disciplinary committee. If we have evidence, they will face the disciplinary committee. But fundamentally, they will be acting as an individual, as individuals. Because our policy is zero tolerance for corruption. And it's written in our hearts. We have said to ourselves, when we get to power, this is one thing that we will deal with, and decisively. You are found to be corrupt, you will face the wrath of the law and be punished. Because, corruption is something that has caused hemorrhage in our resources. You find that people are stealing. And you know, Mr. Museveni is just prepared to superintend over that thieving. when you even know that it's happening. We do know that it has begun from the top. I'll give you the example of what has happened in Parliament, attributed to money that was given during the changing of the constitution, the amendment of the constitution to remove 75 years age limit. The MP for Iganga municipality, the Honorable Mugema Panadol, is on record saying they were given 180 million shillings, each of the MPs who voted to remove age limits. He has not been reprimanded even for a single day. That statement has not been challenged. And because the government and the NRM are quiet about it, we think that is it's the truth that Mr. Mugema said. That is so revealing about the person of Mr. Museveni, who is not only the president of this country, but also the minister of finance. How could this happen before his nose if he didn't have an interest in it? And I will say, while we're in parliament, the 58 of us resisted money for the change of the constitution to remove term limits. The others received money. Very recently, it's just common knowledge, after fighting with Rebecca Kadaga, the Right Honorable Speaker, some 70 forced MPs to return 20 million. But in place of the 20 million, 40 million was given to them. And the execution point was katikati, where corruption was dealt. And you know, we are not talking about village people. We are talking about national leaders.
Honorable, good that you've brought
they
it up.
They are not leading by example. What is the pain of it?
Yes, it's good that they are, it's unfortunate that they are not leading by example, but you're equally not leading by example. You said the FDC has a zero tolerance on corruption. The entire nation was up in arms against the 20 million, including the FDC. But you have members on the parliamentary commission that were in support, that were helping to were the architects of this 20 million that was given to MPs. And you did nothing about them as the opposition, as the FDC. So would it be fair for you to blame Mr. Museveni, yet you equally fold your hands when your members engage in the similar acts just like Mr. Museveni and the NRM?
The Parliament of Uganda has the responsibility of appropriating money. Once the arguments have been made in the House for and against a certain amount to be spent, the responsibility to conclude this is on the members of Parliament. Money was passed properly. The question should be, what would this money be spent on? Would it be accounted for? As we understand as the FDC, we said to ourselves that this money has been passed well and it was supposed to be used in constituencies, just like the Constituency Development Fund that used to be there during our time, would be given to MPs 20 million per year. This money was given for mitigating certain effects of COVID. And we asked our members to spend this money and account for it meticulously. You know that,
Honorable Nandala. That raised the question of morality.
Just wait. Honorable Nandala said, this money is going direct to my health unit. He didn't pocket it. And the other MPs explained to us, say, we are buying food, we are buying whatever. Then comes the big stick of Mr. Museveni, who says this is wrong. Luckily for us, it was a subject of court, and we said to our MPs, wait a minute, don't spend that money. until a decision, court resolves the matter. Court did resolve against the money being spent by MPs. And that is a closed matter. Everybody returned that money. There's nothing to talk about. On the money of iPod that you talked about, I think there was a misunderstanding and misrepresentation in the press. That money was fully accounted for. The auditors have been to FDC to see that the money was well spent on the items, the actual publicity items, which are in FDC for anybody to go and see. They were brought there. I think there was a problem with the reporting. That does not point at corruption. It points at a failure to adhere to procedure and also good accounting practice. But it's not like the money was stolen. So we can move with our hired heads high up in the air as FDC, that we do not tolerate corruption. And when we come to government, that principle will never be dropped. Zero tolerance to corruption.
But Honorable, you said in one of the key issues that you might want to, some of the things that you might want to touch on when you take power as the FDC is realigning the contradictions in the country, ethnicity, reconciliation, a truth and reconciliation committee. But you seem laid back on two things. One, you don't seem to be very forthcoming on the issue of national dialogue. Whenever there is a conversation on national dialogue or something of that sort, that would drive us in this direction. There are always, you always have issues that you raise that might impede national dialogue. But also secondly, you also seem very lukewarm on the issue of coalescing with other opposition members, yet you agree that national consensus is the only way you're going to defeat Mr. Museveni is by coalescing as the opposition.
We don't go to a dialogue without an agenda. I am sure that, Nicholas, you might be referring to the summit of the iPod. I'm not sure whether that is what you're referring to. But if that is what you're referring to...
But Honorable, just to be clear, yes, there are issues with the summit of the iPod. You've had issues with the national dialogue organized by the Elders Forum. You have had issues with people that have tried to make efforts to have a conversation between the FDC with the chairman of the NRM.
Do we have to talk to the chairman of NRM? The nation of Uganda is bigger than just the chairman of NRM. I think really, to bring this to context, we should be talking about a national dialogue where everybody is represented, not just two parties, three parties. So it's the kind of dialogue that we are talking about, because it is not the political parties that are suffering most or their leaders. It is the population of Uganda who should have a say. And so if we had to have a dialogue, it should be embracing. It should be inclusive. It should be representative of the people of Uganda and their aspirations. That is the kind of dialogue we are looking at. This thing of Elders Forum being put together to please Museveni, we are not going to be part of that kind of dialogue. This one here of iPod for people to go and just be seen on cameras with Museveni, we cannot fall for such traps. So we will participate in serious dialogue. We will participate in dialogue that we believe is going to drive the nation to the best direction that it should take. We will advocate for dialogue that will result into something good for Ugandans, not for somebody who has got his own selfish interests to use us to portray themselves as people who are talking to the opposition. No, no, no. The FDC does not fall for such very petty things. We can't. And you know, talking about coalescing as political parties, we have had a history to this as the FDC. You will remember that we had, ahead of the election of 2006, the Inter-Party Cooperation, the IPC. That brought was meant to bring together the FDC, the DP, UPC. I think at the time we had CP as well. And the front runner in this was the Democratic Party. We agreed to go to Kololo after signing the MOU of the IPC. Tents were erected for the four participating political parties. DP posted just one person. The whole entire leadership was not there. And I remember, I think it was the Honorable John Kawanga who came. The UPC, I think, posted also one person. And I think it was the Honorable Patrick Mwonda who came, the late Patrick Mwonda. And so there was no goodwill even after the papers were signed. We have always also agreed with our partners and have been betrayed. And I'll give the example of an agreement that was reached about trying to get two positions from the nine positions that the NRM posts in the East African Legislative Assembly. And we agreed that parties in the opposition, each party at least needed one representative. So we said our brothers in the DP are not represented. Our brothers in the UPC are not represented. We had two positions at the time given to us by resolutions. And NRM had nine. So John Patrick Amama Mbabazi, the then Prime Minister, led the negotiations. And we agreed as political parties in the opposition that none of us should post a candidate unless this matter of the two positions from the NRM was resolved. And signature was put on paper, ink on paper. Before the ink dried, the DP and the UPC were nominating candidates. And nominating candidates for the two positions that were previously held by the FDC. And this explains why for now two terms the FDC has not been in the East African Legislative Assembly. So the question of trust arises. We were in the TDA here in Bukolobi. All of you remember. In the TDA, people went trusting each other. For us in the FDC, we noticed that things were not going wrong, we were going right when we began to hear murmurs coming from inside the room where the TDA was sitting. And we said, this is an aborted venture. It may not be good for us to continue the TDA. And, you know, time absolved us. There was a realization that our suspicion was actually founded.
Honorable, Betty Kamia,
listen to me. Betty Kamia left. Where is she? The NRM. So she was posturing as an opposition person in that meeting, and yet her heart was with the NRM. Gilbert Bukenya, who was even at a certain point being considered as the joint opposition candidate. Where is he? He's gone back to the fold, hobnobbing with Mr. Museveni, whom he pretended to be opposed to.
Honorable, you seem to be saying that everyone should coalesce behind you. You either lead the fold or it should be nothing.
No.
And that came out about
far
a week
from
ago.
It, all that I am saying is that for any kind of coalition to happen, if we have to coalesce, there have to be certain factors we will be sure about. The first is the level of trust we have in the individuals we wish to coalesce with. Museveni is on rampage today buying everybody. And we are not going to take chances, you know, coalescing or even giving our flag to somebody who may end up dropping the flag because they don't have a commitment and going to Museveni. So trust. Number two, we'll have to ask questions about what the person or the group that we are coalescing with is bringing on the table. What is it that they have to offer?
What is number it that three, you want them to offer?
Number three, we are going to also ask questions about what their interest in the coalition is, because these are very fundamental things. At the moment, when I look at the political playing ground, I notice that we are the lone voices talking about an election which will not bring change. The others are moving, thinking that the election by itself is going to bring change.
Honorable, these are very good points, but the wondering is, you're the first party president that is not interested in national leadership, and it seems you're not ambitious at all. That has been interpreted as you being a walking stick of Dr. Kizza Besigye.
My ambition is controlled. I walked into the leadership of the FDC unnoticed. I've just told you that. If I didn't have an ambition, I would not be the FDC president today, because I wasn't forced to contest.
The feeling is that you are FDC president to safeguard Dr. Kizza Besigye's interest.
What is there to gain from the FDC, you know, as an individual? Would you think that somebody would gain the presidency through FDC just because the FDC? Would they have to have a puppet in FDC in order to be allowed to compete for the presidency, or flag bearer for presidential election? No. We have systems. So even if one wanted to be a puppet, it is not possible for one to be a puppet, because decisions of the party are not taken by an individual. Decisions of the party are taken, are made through the organs of the party.
But there are allegations that before you go to the party, you first have kitchen cabinets at Katonga.
Those are, I'm happy that you say the allegations, they are not founded at all. And as I have said, I don't know how big that kitchen cabinet would be. It would take the whole of the National Delegates Conference to go and meet Dr. Besigye for a decision to pass in the National Delegates Conference, because these are over 1,200 people. The top organ, NEC by itself, the national, first of all, even the National Council, which is the second most important organ of the party, has 135 people, because we have representation from one person from every district of the country. This can expand, especially with the question of the cities and new administrative areas. Next in the order of precedence is the NEC, which has about 80 members. So, you know, for anybody to say that the FDC can be under the control of Dr. Kizza Besigye, no, the president of FDC is Paul and is here.
The FDC cannot be under the control of Dr. Kizza Besigye, but the party president, Patrick Amuriat Oboy. Thank you very much for making it to the show. Be sure to catch the checkpoint tomorrow, same time. Good night.